First, allow for duplication. I really, really believe that creative people, they need space. Creative people need air to breathe. They need freedom. If you tell creative people what they have to do, if you bury them in standard operating procedures, I tell you, all what you will get is exactly what you told them. But you don't get anything new. You don't get breakthroughs. You don't get new approaches. Freedom, I think, is fundamental for innovation. And we reflect that in the way we organize ourselves. We reflect this in our management model. I'm convinced to achieve this degree of freedom, you need to delegate decision-making as low into the organization as possible. And I also believe there's an advantage if you have as autonomous and as independent units in your organization. To illustrate this, for pharma research, in our organization, we have 4 units which are all directly reporting to myself. So we have Genentech in San Francisco. We have a unit, a research and early development unit in Switzerland. We have one in Zhugai. And we have a function which is called licensing and partnering, which taps into external innovation, which of course is also crucially important. And all of those 4, they directly report to myself. This is in contrast to many other companies where you typically would have 1 global R&D head, and often this global R&D head would not even directly report to the CEO. Now, you mentioned the Genentech acquisition. So let me just tell you a little anecdote in this context. So we bought out the full ownership of Genentech 4 years ago. This was a big acquisition. I was just in the job, $50 billion US dollar acquisition. And my biggest question was, how do we make sure that we keep this innovative spirit? How do we make sure that we retain the scientists? How do we make sure that we keep this power of innovation, even this specific culture you immediately feel if you get to the place? And the organization model has followed exactly what I just described. We simply kept it as an independent unit, and the head of research and development is directly reporting to myself. And one of the biggest compliments he made me recently was, I mean, he didn't think about that context, but he said to me, you know what, I've been reflecting on this Genentech Roche integration, which went well. And he said, you know what is interesting? I realized today that I have much more freedom than I ever had. I have more freedom than I had when Genentech was an independent company. And I'm totally convinced the success of this integration has a lot to do with the fact that we gave full freedom to this organization. They could just, go on doing their thing. And they have been extremely productive over the last 4 years, actually, bringing out many very important medicines. Now, in a large organization like ours, you will always have people, predominantly in the headquarters, who want to streamline things, who want to get more efficient, who want to, put locations together because you have savings, want to put into place new standard operating procedures. And they are well-intended, and they do that because they want to eliminate waste, they want to eliminate duplication. My advice to you is, just ignore them and provide the space for the really, really creative people. Now, that brings me to the second element I'd like to touch on, and it's very much related to that, the focus on a few guiding principles. Now, if you choose a decentralized management model as we do, at the same time, you need some cohesion across the group. you need some framework. But we really focus on a few principles. We have a common sense of purpose. We have a set of values which are not negotiable. There are a few principles, like the compliance with our code of conduct. We have certain powers reserved by the headquarters. For example, when it comes to big acquisitions, investments, key people decisions, etc. But this is a very, very small document. It is available to every employee on the intranet. And beyond that, the respective functional units or the local organizations, they can do whatever they want to do. They can set up their own decision-making procedures. We as a headquarter, we leave them alone. People sometimes argue if you are a complex organization, then you need more of these rules. I think the contrary is the case. If you are a big and a large organization, then it's even more important that you keep your fingers out of everything and that you focus back on a few key principles and give enough freedom by doing that to your organization. Now, so far I have focused about the decentralized management style, the importance of giving freedom, focusing on a few key principles. That is all fine, but then you need people who embrace this freedom. You need people who take responsibility. You need people who take initiative. And that brings me right to my third element I want to touch on. Beware of consultants and visionary leaders. Sorry, Bill. Now, I admit, I also used consultants, typically in a very targeted and selective way. And from time to time, this makes sense. But my experience is that you have, in particular, the weak managers who surround themselves with lots of consultants, advisors, mentors, coaches, what have you. It's the weak managers who typically don't know what they want. They're insecure. I'm equally skeptical about visionary leaders. They make for great stories which are told in books or on TV. But I fundamentally believe that innovation, and leadership in general, by the way, doesn't come from the top. I think it comes bottom up. It's not about some revelations from the top. What I prefer is to have thousands of people within the organization, who follow their own passion, their own conviction, who follow their own dreams. That's what you need, and that's how you make an innovative company. We had a researcher here in the US. He was working on a new approach to treat cancer, and actually nobody believed in this approach. It was a thousand reasons why this would never work. Now, this scientist was very convinced about this mode of action and that something could be done about it. And actually what he did is he spent time in the company lab over the weekends to work on this specific project. Turned out that with all the experiments which were done, eventually there was evidence that this mode of action actually is useful and that it could work. And then we developed the medicine and eventually it became Avastin, which is today one of the biggest cancer drugs on the market. It has a turnover of $6 billion US dollars, and it's still nicely growing. Now, I bet with you, if you would have brought in consultants, I bet with you what would have happened. I mean, I know the line already. They would have, and by the way, there are lots of consultants in pharmaceutical companies who do portfolio reviews, look at R&D productivity, you know, thousands of them. And I tell you what they do. They come in, and the first thing they make is a stakeholder analysis. So who, in some form, has influence on the decision making? And they map that in a big way. And then, of course, the next thing you can rely on that is a questionnaire to all the stakeholders. You know, a long document where you fill out lots of questions, and then they collect all of that. They, you know, do lots of power charts around it. They find patterns. They do effect analysis. And then, of course, they come up with a big conclusion. We have to focus our resources on the most promising projects. And what we have learned from the organization is that we should focus the money here and here and here. And I guarantee you, what you get is a kind of average conglomerate of opinions. And this Avastin project, for sure, would have been regarded as a waste of money, and it would have been discarded. Because breakthrough innovation very often is going against the common opinion. Because if everybody would have known that this works, then of course it wouldn't have been an innovation anymore. Then everybody in the world would have worked on this specific mode of action. So if you ask everybody, you know, where shall we focus our resources, guess what you get at the end of the day. If I look back, the wise decision of management at that time was, it's a very simple one, but not irrelevant one. They just left the company lab open over the weekend. That was their contribution. And it paid off many, many times. Yeah. How are we doing time-wise? Okay, good, good. Let me get right to the next element. Again, a bit related to that. Celebrate failures. Now, of course, if you then come up with a new medicine like Avastin, you won't be short of people who want to celebrate this success. And that's okay. That's fine. We should celebrate such successes. But the reality, of course, in our industry is that over 90% of the projects fail. So the norm is failure. And I think, therefore, it is extremely important. If you want to thrive innovation, if you want people to take risks, it is very, very important that leaders recognize the good work which is done. And I personally, you know, over lunch or whatever, I call up some of the project members, and then we discuss a project, we discuss why it has failed, we discuss what we can learn from it. And then, you know, sometimes what I do is I open a bottle of champagne and we officially celebrate the failure. And it has an enormous impact, because if you do things like that as a CEO, especially if you take a photo which is then distributed everywhere, then you know, the indirect message is the important thing. Because what people realize, it is okay to fail. You know, it's appreciated that we take risks. It's appreciated that people have the courage to try out new things, which more often than not will eventually fail. So let me come to the last thought, the last idea, which I feel is also very important. Now, you know, you spoke about Roche being the biggest biotech company today in the world. If I look back over the last couple of years, you know, I had the privilege to launch very important new medicines, the financial results were fine, the share price went up, etc. But make no mistake, much of this success is due to my predecessor and actually to my predecessor. And you should know that at Roche we have long tenures of CEOs. So my predecessor started in the 70s, almost 35 years ago, my predecessor 20 years ago. And they took decisions at the time in terms of where to invest. They took decisions in terms of important acquisitions like Genentech. we took the first stake in Genentech at the very early 90s. You know, this was at a time when people couldn't even spell biotech. There was no product. There was nothing at that time. And people had the courage to take the risk and to think in the long term. Everybody knew that there wouldn't be success immediate, that it would take time. And indeed, it took a lot of time. I also remember at the time that our share price went down. People didn't appreciate the fact that you take such a long-term approach. And it took more than a decade until Genentech actually turned profitable. And if you look at it today, much of the success of Roche is due to our success in biologics, which is directly related to decisions which were literally taken 20 years ago. I think for a CEO, it is extremely important. I think for the organization overall, but in particular for the CC, it is important to think in the long term, not to follow some fashionable trends in the short term, to accept that some of the investors are more focused on the quarterly results, but still ignore it and do the right thing for the long term. And I hope that one day the successor of my successor will come back here to the MIT and can refer to some of the contributions I initiated these days.